This is the most powerful seat in all of the Anglican Church. Right here we have the seat of the Archbishop of Canterbury, here in Canterbury, England. I've come to one of the most important churches here in England for a few reasons, actually for a lot of reasons. One of the main reasons is this is the very first Gothic cathedral built in this country. And of course, England is becoming very famous for Gothic cathedrals. But the other important thing is this small candle right here, and someone was about to fall down uneven steps over here. So the reason I'm whispering is because we are in a place of peace, so unlike other guests, I'm speaking a little bit lower. But welcome everyone, let me know where you're watching from. Hey everyone, nice to see you here. Thank you so much for tuning in. There's very poor cell phone reception here, so I have to speak very low because I'm in the church, but I have to like move slowly, and this will also be short. But tune back today at 6 p.m. New York City time. That's the time. I'll be back 6 p.m. New York City time in the area with better cell phone reception. But nonetheless, let's do a nice mini live here at Canterbury Cathedral. I can't show you the full thing. You'll see a short video where you can see a little bit more of the cathedral. And the other thing is patrons will get a much longer uncut video of what I shot for TikTok. So let me show you. So right here is the one bench test I wish I could do. Right here is the seat of the Archbishop of Canterbury. That is basically the Pope for the Anglican religion. So if people don't know, Anglicanism split off during the reign of King Henry VIII to become its own thing away from the Holy See, which was overseen by the Pope in the Vatican. In order to replace the figurehead that used to be the Pope, they end up upgrading the Archbishop of Canterbury to that position. And since then, the man who's in charge of the top Christian religion in this country sits right there. So there's a lot of people here, a lot of school kids. But Henry VIII did something very, very bad. King Henry VIII. Many might know that this man had a vicious vendetta against the Catholic Church. It's one of the main reasons we, the English, no longer pay attention to the Pope. But while he did keep this cathedral, thank God, he decided to destroy something within it. Right here used to stand the huge, beautiful, lavish, wonderful tomb of St. Thomas Becket. Now you might recognize the name Becket because it's a few famous plays that have been told over and over throughout the centuries. Let me know what's your favorite Becket play. There's one that's very famous. This tomb used to be right here, but Henry VIII decided to take down the tomb, destroy it, take out the remains of that tomb, which was the remains of St. Thomas, and burn them. There's no longer any remains remaining of St. Thomas. But why? Well, one of the main reasons was because this was the center for many Catholic pilgrims. Now, you might know a famous tale, especially if you grew up in the English-speaking world, America, England, Scotland, Australia, New Zealand, you probably know very well the Canterbury Tales. Canterbury Tales is one of the most famous books ever written in the English world. It's written by Geoffrey Chaucer, who follows a series of different characters from both very low-born to very high-born nobility coming here to the pilgrimage of Canterbury. Now, one famous movie that I really enjoy, Heath Ledger, starred in A Knight's Tale. It's based on one of those stories. So they would come here, and this would be one of the top pilgrimage sites for all of Christendom. But who was Thomas Becket? So let me tell you a little bit more here, and then we're gonna walk outside the cathedral so you can see the outside. Welcome, Wendy. I'm going to show you the details here. This is very poor service. I don't have the freedom to walk around as much as I usually would. But I'll show you the details from this perspective. Right over here, we actually have Edward Plantagenet, the Black Prince. I don't know too much about the Black Prince, but I will be doing a video on him because his name sounds badass. And above, we seem to seem to have garments of the Black Prince. The Plantagenets, of course, are a very controversial family in English royal history. Thomas Becket was a man who loved to do a sport that was called hawking. And hawking was another favorite sport of King Henry II. That's how both of them met. That's how both of them connected. According to many stories and many accounts, they ended up becoming very good friends. So much so that Thomas Becket, who wasn't a clergy member, ended up being promoted to the seat of the Archbishop of Canterbury. Basically overnight, he was made into a priest and then became archbishop. Moved up the entire ranking of the hierarchy of the English Catholic Church at that time very quickly. Thomas Becket was a man who was very charismatic. He loved to have lavish entourages. He would go with hundreds of people, 100 footmen, just a lot, huge groups. He would love to travel, especially to France, and he became a gigantic deal in this part of the world and also in France. People really loved him. King Henry II, on the other hand, was a man of much more modest show. He didn't show too much. He didn't walk around with huge entourages. They had a little bit of a different personalities. But then Thomas Becket disagreed with the way that Henry II was ruling, because he did not like that Henry II was promoting all of his friends to very high positions of power in which they did not merit it, they did not earn it, they did not really intend on doing a good job in those positions. At least that's what Thomas Becket thought, and I would assume a lot of other people thought. I'm speculating, but I think a lot of people thought that as well. So Thomas Becket decided to go against King Henry II's style of rule. So much so that King Henry II did not like it, and Thomas Becket decided to go into exile to France. He was not supposed to do that because the Archbishop of Canterbury is not supposed to go off to a foreign country, especially an enemy country, on his own. But Thomas Becket came back, and he continued to defy the king, saying, "No, you must rule being smart. You must rule with elevating people into positions of power that actually deserve it and actually know how to wield that power." It's rather ironic that he was so adamant about that, because Thomas Becket himself rose the ranks very high. But by this time that he came back to England, he actually went over to the Pope. And in France, he met up with him there and tried to resign. He said, "I don't deserve this seat. I did not earn it." The Pope was so moved by that, that he kept him as Archbishop of Canterbury, and that's why he came back. So he comes back to England. He's here in the cathedral, 1170 AD. A few men gather in a nearby tavern, planning that they're gonna do something to the Archbishop. Apparently, King Henry II sent a few knights in order to ruffle him up, in order to scare him a little bit, so he gets in line. One of those knights knew Thomas Becket personally, so they come and see him here in the cathedral, further down, which I'll show in a short video on the TikTok. There's no cell phone reception down there. They see him, try to ruffle him up, but he says immediately as they come, says, "Hey, how are you doing? I'm ready to die." They found that rather weird, And as they try to bully him and ruffle him, he doesn't either resist nor give in. He's a man of completely standing his ground. Well, one of the men gets really pissed off. Apparently it's the man that knows Thomas Becket personally. And Thomas Becket equates this man to the same as being a pimp. And he's insulted. So he takes out his sword and slashes Thomas Becket. Slashes him right across the skull. And then as he slashes that skull, he flicks his sword. And this is rather graphic. His brains come flowing out. A very grisly crime. People are all around looking at this crime ensuing, and they're scared. But they know that they just witnessed something important. So the story spreads of this grisly murder. Many firsthand accounts of it. And then a miracle happens. As they're coming to recover the body, they notice that, as I mentioned, his brain splattered out. He was cut up, very grisly. When they found him, they saw his face completely intact. Only a streak of blood right down the middle, but his face looked like he's someone who died in a serene circumstance. Then, as they were removing the body, they took out his shirt and found out that his shirt was tattered, covered in worms, and had spikes. That shirt was weird because he was a man of a lot of means. He had a lot of money. He had money to buy a very good shirt. Why did he wear such a terrible shirt that caused him a lot of pain? And this is when a lot of people started talking, because they knew that this man was basically confagulating himself. He was doing his penance by wearing this very painful shirt, similar to how some people would whip themselves or some people would put glass in their shoe. He was committing penance. At that moment, they knew that he was a pious man, at least from their point of view. And that elevated him into a martyr. Martyrs, you know, usually was a title left over for people in early Christianity, the ones who died on the cross upside down in Rome. They didn't have martyrs for centuries, but they called him a martyr because of that. So Thomas Becket was made into a martyr, made into a saint very quickly. And this became a massive pilgrimage site with his tomb right over here. But King Henry VIII, as I mentioned later, many, many centuries later, decided to destroy it. And now the only thing that burns is this single candle right here. So this candle stays lit up all day. Still a very popular pilgrimage site. All right, now let's continue walking. I hope you enjoyed that story. Let's go outside. As I mentioned in the short video, I'll show you more of the cathedral. If you want to be a patron, you'll see all the clips I filmed of the cathedral inside available to all of you. So let's try and walk outside. Hopefully there's good service here. Let me know if you enjoyed the story. Let's go walk outside. bad service in the cathedral. Let me know if you see me and hear me.